Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Zitezo Live Better Show. I am Karani Saraf, and I will be hosting today's event. Zitezo aims to help you live better by bringing to you expert views and recommendations for your well-being. Today, we have with us a very special guest, and I'm sure most of you know her, but to those who don't, I'm very excited to introduce her to you all. I would like to welcome Dr. Anu Mehta to the Live Better Show.
Hi, Tarini.
Good evening, Dr. Mehta. It's our privilege to have you with us.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Dr. Mehta is not only a pioneer in her field, but the first one who used MetaHealth in conjunction with information technology, Ness Health. She believes that every psychological and physiological symptom, ranging from a simple stomach ache to a disability of sorts, has a meaning and has dedicated her life to help people reflect and look within themselves in order to understand their emotion and its root cause. Dr. Mehta inspires change every day by empowering people through her work. She has been recognized all around the world for her accomplishments and discoveries. Her journey into MetaHealth started from her personal experience of child abuse, and that has driven her to create and practice techniques which tap inner conflicts at the unconscious level. And her expertise in Ness Health and MetaHealth has successfully helped a 6-day-old baby overcome her walking disability by the age of 1.5 years. Not only is she a MetaHealth expert, but a sought-after speaker, producer, and author. Today, Dr. Mehta will explain how inner imbalances and the external environment cause our body to react and how we all must address these signals. While Dr. Mehta shares her insights, if anyone has any questions, please feel free to write them on our Facebook or YouTube comment section, and we will try to address them if time permits. Thank you, Dr. Mehta, for joining us for today's Live Better Show.
Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you for honoring us here. But yeah, many of us are hearing the term MetaHealth for the first time. So could you please explain what MetaHealth really is?
So MetaHealth, health, basically, I think everybody knows what health is all about. And people talk about to be healthy means if I sleep well, if I eat well, if I, you know, don't have too much of alcohol, I don't have too much of drugs, if I do alom vilom, that's the breathing exercises, then I'm fine. But we know of so many people who did have a good discipline in their life. They also slept at time, like maybe even at 10 o'clock at night, yet they had a disease. So what is disease all about? The MetaHealth talks about a 360-degree view of what really a disease is. So disease, if we break down the word dis-ease, it basically means something I'm not at ease with, something I'm not in comfort with. And most of the times, there is a stressful event that happens in our life. Now, what do you mean by a stressful event? It could be that, Tarini, there are times when I'm sure you've been through exams, and there are also times when maybe you didn't do that well, and there are also times when you did extremely well, but there's always that, you know, oh my God, I don't know what's going to happen, right? And maybe your teacher just comes 15 minutes before your exam and tells you, Tarini, you're good for nothing. She shouts at you, you're good for nothing, you're horrible. Your father just called up and he was saying we need to throw you out of the school because da 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 da. Let's just take a hypothetical situation. Now, this could be a stressful event for you. Can we stop our emotions from taking toll on us if somebody really does that to us? If somebody really shouts at us? What's going to happen to your chemistry of the body? What's going to happen to the biology of your body? At that point, you're going to sit down and say, oh my God, I don't know what my dad has said. Oh my God, I don't know what my teacher is talking about. And you're going to go a spiral down. Will you be able to cope up with the situation? Depends on your attitude. you may still go for your exam, shut all this jargon off and give your exam well and come back. Or you may just crumble down, cry, howl, and not be able to give the exam. Now, something has put you not at ease. But what if after the exam was done, let's say you still went ahead because you got this great attitude, you did your exam, you came back, and you just stood there and people came back and your teacher came back and said, Tarinthi, we were just joking with you. Will you forget what really happened? You will be obsessing about it. Let's say she doesn't say, oh, we were joking. And they leave it for the next one day to just kind of push you to whatever. So maybe the whole night you don't sleep. You're obsessing. You're wondering, why is that happening? A lot of obsession, don't you find, not just in bad things, but also in good things? Let's say you fall in love. You fall in love with a man you should have never fallen in love. Your parents won't approve of it. And of course, your friends will come back and say, how could you? He's 40 years of age. You're just 16. You can't do that to yourself. But you know, you can't have control over your emotions. And he's just so handsome. He's just such a nice guy. He's come and told you, Tarini, I love you. And like, you know, all those glowy eyes, and you're sitting down and saying, he loves me, he loves me not. He loves me, he loves me not. This is also an obsession. So the stress can be a good stress, or a stress can be a bad stress. But something that doesn't let your life remain the way it was before is a stress that's going to cause your disease. And that's what mental health looks at. Thank you.
Wow, that's so interesting. Because like most of us consider mental health and physical health as two separate branches, but mental health like links them both together. So you're known to use mental health in conjunction with NEST Health to like have a wider, to help a wider age group. So could you tell us how you do that?
Okay. So first of all, you said something very interesting before we go to the NEST, and that was that mental health does combine mental health and physical health together. It's because if you look at your body, Tarini, if you look at our body, our head wasn't cut and sent somewhere else. Most of us believe that the top head should definitely go to the mental health, and the down below this, everything is to be done by the other doctors. Well, that's completely a myth. If our whole body is connected, how can we separate it out just for the sake of, you know, how do you say, making it easy? It's not that easy. It's actually very easy, very simple, and we've complicated it by separating the body out. Secondly, NEST Health is a nutri-energetic system, which is actually an information system. It talks about our body not as body parts only. It says our body is basically a hologram, which means if you go to the acupuncturist, they will tell you our whole body is in our hands, our whole body is in our lips, our whole body is in our eyes, our whole body can be in our feet. An acupuncturist will not even use your whole body. They might just use your body parts to kind of work on the area of the body that is not functioning well. So NEST people have found a system which is far more advanced. Of course, they use the Chinese medicine, they use the acupuncture and acupressure, and they use various technologies. And so 40 years of work that Peter Faser did. Peter Faser is not with us anymore. He's not alive. He passed away, I think, last year, if I'm not mistaken, with deep regard to him. He created the system wherein he realized that every bit of us is just energy. And what's amazing, we are just protons, ions, and electrons. Physics. Oh, my God. Chemistry comes in. Physics comes in. And we are behaving. We are thinking that our body is solid, whereas our body is not solid. Our body is actually, can you imagine, high density of ions and protons. And there are people who can actually pass through your body. And there are people who can pass through the structures. So basically, we are energies, and our symptoms are just a distortion in that energy. So when we are not feeling well, it means that something has gone wrong in the information that was fed to us. Like, a perfectly nice looking girl might feel she's ugly. And I've worked with a lot of women who think they are ugly. Actually, they're very, very pretty. But they somehow land up at my place and say, I can't look at myself. I said, what happened? Oh, I don't think it's important, but I think I feel very ugly. This is energy. We are perceiving ourselves to be and then treating our body organs in a certain way. So what NESS has created is a system wherein you can scan the human body. Very fascinating for me, because my father wasn't well and he couldn't talk. So he fell down one day and he was in the pool of blood, after which he was paralyzed, and he stayed alive after that for about 10, 12 years. And my need to kind of assist him or help him in some way helped me to find the NESS system. So the NESS system is not a very new system, but has evolved totally over the period of time. I could just scan his body by a touch on his skin. And when I touch on his skin, it's like a remote control. I touch on his skin and his whole body gets scanned by a scanner, wherein I get 10 different windows. Without him talking, I know what he's feeling, how his chakras are, what is his nutrition status, does he have toxins in his body, which meridian is not functioning properly, how is he, is he having high vitality or low vitality, what kind of medicines can be, what kind of information can be given to him to correct the system. And this is where you could, you know, bring in small water bottles, which was so the bottles are really 10 ml bottles, and it's water fitted in with information that's fed by the computer, something that's very alien even today. I used to watch Star Trek in my time, and we used to have those machines buzzing over us, and it's got fitted, something like that. You can work on the body with it, you can work off the body with it. I have seen burnt patients getting okay. I've seen hurt and pain getting okay. And like you mentioned, we worked on a six-day-old baby. She had come home, and thanks to Cyril Brooke and Rose Heyman, who have taught me, they were in Australia. So Cyril Brooke is still there. Rose Heyman is again not there in this world. A lot of my mentors who came, taught me, are not still there in this world. But I think what they taught me stays with me and lives in me. So we worked with this little child. This baby had come with blisters all over her genitals. Like literally the sores all over her genitals. And her legs were bent. The doctor said that she'll never be able to walk. And then Rose and I started working with her. We literally took coconut water, muslin cloth, and soaked it with infraceuticals and put it across on her genitals. And we worked with the machine right on her legs, and we were able to save one leg completely of hers. The other leg still had to be put in the cast by the doctor to straighten it. But when, by the time, from the time that he had seen her to the time that they put her one leg in the cast, it was almost like he asked the people, how did that happen? How did her leg become straight? And well, it's possible. You work on it, it's possible. Everything is possible. We also did the scan for the mother and realized that the mother was very angry and the baby was very angry. Remember, we can pick up the emotions. And started questioning and asking her, why are you so angry? What's happening there? And obviously the child cannot answer, but the mother answered, why are you angry? And she said, well, at 6 months, there is a ceremony that is performed by the Maharashtrian community in Mumbai, wherein they celebrate the coming of the baby. And of course, the sweets are distributed. And the mother picked up a certain mithai. And when she ate that sweet, everybody looked at her and said, oh, ladki hogi. there's going to be a baby girl. And instead of celebrating that, it became one of the biggest anger spots in the house. Elders were angry with her that she was going to get a baby girl home. Ill treatment started. Mother wasn't treated properly. She started fearing for the baby, started fearing for herself. What was the baby doing? Baby was trying to change her genitals by being born with the rash there. She could not stand straight under this much of pressure. And so she was really bow-legged completely. Well, she walks properly and she runs, and there is nothing wrong with her physically. And unfortunately, I think her mother left her much later and couldn't stay in that environment. Unfortunately for the kid was left with the father and the mother. Actually, it's a sad state of affairs. She doesn't have her mom along with her. And I think the man got remarried again. Nothing new about these stories, is it? So that's how Ness helps. And it has helped my father, who couldn't talk to us. So I knew from Ness what was wrong with him and could help me and help him and assist him. Thank you for that question.
That's a lot to process. And I think it's quite brilliant how all you have to do is reach out. And in your words, agree. Ki dimag bhi kharab ho sakta hai. But on a serious note, it's very important to accept and address these issues. So how can one actually understand their inner conflicts and address them on an unconscious level?
Thank you so much for that question. So subconscious is actually the one that drives us. And subconscious is like literally like the iceberg down. You can only see a tip of it on the top. So how do we trap that subconscious and really understand when the client comes to us, is he talking rubbish? Is he speaking lies to us? Because that can happen. Imagine if I come to you and say, mera husband mujhko bahut marta hai. Har roj marta hai, madam. You will believe me. All I have to do is dress up badly. Or if I come and say, even after getting beaten up, I wear makeup properly and say, oh, I'm perfectly all right. You'd believe me. We use our tongue more to lie than to assist ourselves and assist other people. And we come to a therapist like me only when all other gates are closed. It's like saying, I don't have a choice. Achha main pahunchi jaati. And I understand that because there can be a huge fear of people saying that you're mad. But going back to the question, I use a system wherein I use drawings. And what I do is I ask people to draw self-drawing, a landscape, and I ask them to do the family drawing. We could also use puppets, sand. These are all non-verbal stories by which you can actually capture the subconscious in a very nice way. Here I must acknowledge my teachers, Kirti Bakshi, Bernie Siegel, and all the books that I have read and all the people who've come across me, along with Dr. Kwesi, who's taught me about Lucia. Now, the good part is when you start looking at the language of the drawing and the colors, and you look at the sand and the puppets and the dolls that you could be using for the therapy, you'll be amazed with what all you can find out. And it just fascinates me beyond, it's like a new world opens up. So why don't we look at the drawings and just show you rather than just speaking about it?
That would be wonderful.
Yeah. So. So I'm taking you guys into the world of drawings. And this is the first drawing. It's called the neurographic painting. This kind of painting I've learned from Krista, who is in Australia. Neurographic painting is a new system of drawing. If you look at it, none of the lines are straight. This specific drawing is neurographic rain and is utilized to create something new for me. This research is being done in Russia, and this was created to create new neural paths in the brain. So you can actually today, there is nothing like that your brain and the new neuropaths cannot be created. You don't even have to do one activity 21 days to create it. All you need to do is sit down on a paper and pencils and maybe your sketches and color pencils, whichever medium you like. And there is a specific way of going about. So I put an intention there. And each big balloon kind of things that you see down, these are the resources that I have put for myself. The rain on the top is falling on this, and it's actually, each part has got a resource. So I'm growing my knowledge, I'm growing my things, and you're practically putting your visualization down on the paper and creating it. This is one of the ways you can actually alter your subconscious by creating new neuropaths in the brain. If we could go to the next drawing, please. Thank you. These are the kind of drawings that I ask my clients to make. I ask them to make a family drawing. Now, very important what colors are used. Very important to see. First, let me give you a brief of this lady. She had come to me about 4 months back. I asked her to make a family drawing. And I also asked, she was going through a tough period with her husband. She wanted to divorce him because he didn't talk to her at all. And she did not feel connected to him. She was at her mom's house, and her mom is a doctor. Her dad's a doctor. So they don't believe in my kind of work. It's like, this is hocus pocus. Yet she reluctantly drew this drawing and sent it across. I want you to look at this drawing. What do you see here? Let me just look at it and tell me, what do you see here, really?
I see a man and a woman in the center, probably the couple, and on either side, their daughters.
She's telling me she doesn't get along with him. How is she standing?
She's not holding his hand.
No, she's not holding his hand. In fact, the arm on his side is like a stump. It's not there. And he's stretching himself out. So when she says he does not communicate, she means he does not communicate with sitting down and having discussions and talking to her. But actually, this drawing shows that he is spreading himself out, and he's the one who's actually connected. And she's the one who does not have one arm on the other side. In fact, her one daughter, which is on the right side, is the younger one. And on the left side is the elder one. And the elder daughter is the one who she's reaching out to. And if you look at the elder daughter's hand, is again not there. She doesn't know what she's holding. It again ends like a little stump over there. If we look at the younger daughter, can you see how shoulders are created for her? As if put a lot of responsibility, the square. They're not feminine shoulders at all. Yeah. Also the colors which are used. So Bernie Siegel always says, if you have colors like these which are used, like a purple color, this specific color is a color which is of showing worry, death. These are the colors of not of life. These are the colors of something not being okay, something not being in resonance. When we look at the whole family being drawn in this, and I asked her, do you ever feel that, you know, you might not be there in this world, and there is any worry like that? She says, well, you know, my husband is constantly working, and I constantly feel he's not there. It feels like death. It feels like my life is not there. Also something to notice. Did you notice the shadow there?
Yeah, it's on all four of them.
Yes, but the shadow looks more like a gun pointed towards the younger daughter. Sorry, towards the elder daughter. Can you see that?
Yeah. Yeah, I can see.
Isn't that really interesting? We take a photograph, but it actually leaves a shadow over there and feels like they are all under the shadow of, how do you say, something horrible will happen. And that's something that was a focus of her prominent thoughts. She also has a lot of pink over there. She wants to be in love. She wants to feel the Ishkwala love. But does she really feel it? Does she really connect? And also, if you look at the back of the paper, it's like there's nothing there. There is no trees, nothing. It's just vacant. So is she telling me everything? Not really. So there is a lot with this one drawing, I could go on for next half an hour. But that's not the point. Let's see all the varieties so that you can get more. Let's go to the next one. So the next drawing, this is of her husband who reluctantly drew things. Now, can you see the house is literally trembling?
Yeah.
Can you see that he's put his house on stumps?
Oh,
and
wow.
The house is made in brown color, almost a shivering house, looking at that his wife has left him and gone. And this is the drawing that he's made where he's shivering because he feels his house is going to crumble down. He has very high expectations of himself. He's put the house on a little bit of like a stilt on the top. And yet the house seems to be like tilted. It's not straight. So obviously he's aware of something not being okay. If we look at the windows over there and we look at the cross sign, the windows with the cross sign like this always shows up when people are very religious inside the house. So I asked her, who is very religious? She says, my mother-in-law is always doing rituals. So that's one of the things that really hassles me. Also look, how can you plant a tree in a small pot? These are three members of the family which are standing very stunted. And the trees represent people. They don't have the roots. There is no rooting. It's like they are not rooted well. They are standing. There is no color there. There is no nothing shaded. And look at the car. The car is like a toy car there. So I asked her, do you have a car? And she says, well, he wants to buy one. Can you now see how his imagination has got created over here? But the good thing to see is that he sees the sun is created in the east of the paper. The sun which is there can be created in east or the west of the paper. Right now where the sun is, it's the west of the paper, not the east of the paper. And if we are looking at the west of the paper, he knows that his wife is very stubborn and the hope is very, very low. Some people also look at that yellow color and say he wants to spread knowledge. But if you look at again the clouds on the top, and numbers have a meaning, three clouds on the top could be showing his three members of the family. Now remember, these drawings were actually used to find out a lot of work that Bernie Siegel does, and even Kubler-Ross, who was his teacher, who taught him. They were using this for unwell people. Susan Buck is another one, a very big author who writes on the drawings, and all of them actually have sat down and said that it's for to find out whether the child will get out of his disease or not. They were primarily used for kids, and they picked up all the drawings and they would see the sketch and the journey of the kid. And that's how they collected their data, and they came up with something that was very, very amazing. I'm not just using it for people who are unwell. I'm using it for you and me who may have an ailment or may not have an ailment. Let's go to the next drawing.
Yeah.
Look at this drawing and look at the phallic symbol. Can you see the phallic symbol?
Yeah.
Can you see the penis right at the end on the right side of the paper? And on this 1, 2, 3, 4 stairs to climb it. This man has huge problems with his sexuality. And the marriage has been really suffering because he has problems with his sexuality. He has also developed some kind of a cyst, which is showing with the tree growing on the side of the penis, side of the hill. And yeah, it's very interesting how the body parts will be shown in some form or the other. And you can actually look over there and ask the person question. Again, you can see the cross on the window. And I asked him, who is very religious in your house? His mom is extremely religious person and would like things to be done in a certain way. A lot of rituals that you will see with these cross signs which are showing. It's like the cross of the Christ that shows up very, very interestingly. Let's go to the next picture. I just picked up a few so that you guys can get an idea. This is a lady who wants to be free, wants to be happy. She's also going through a difficult marriage, hasn't dissolved still, but she's trying to find her way. And look again, the background is absolutely empty. Something to really notice is that she has got a picnic basket, a picnic mat, and put over there. She's standing in the sun. The sun is there. She's worn the yellow dress to show hope. But why is she not sitting down? Why is she not sitting down on that mat and relaxing? And is she going to do picnic all alone? This shows me a very lonely lady who wants to relax and doesn't know how to. She doesn't know how to sit down. So she will keep earning. She will keep buying things. She will keep doing stuff. But she doesn't have time to enjoy it. Let's go to the next picture. All the next pictures are hers. So you will have a look. Can you now see again she's drawn herself taller than before?
Yeah.
And she's got the fence behind. And people are behind the fence. But she's not looking at them. Why is she not looking at the people? And all those people I asked, who are they behind the fence? And she said, well, those are my family members. How can they reach her when she's got the fence so high? Are they going to jump over? Again, she has a mat put on the sand with an umbrella, with a book, with the drink on the one side. But why is she standing? Why is she not lying down? And every bit of that drawing means something. Her sun is in the east, so we know it's the rising sun. So I still have hope that she'll be able to work on her stuff and will be able to deal with it. The next drawing, please. Can you now see again the phallic symbol showing?
Yeah.
Very good. In the form of the people who are standing next to the coffin. Go yeah. back to the first, go back before this, before drawing. Can you see? No, no. The last one. The last one that we were looking at. Yeah. Just yes. In where she is standing, this is her drawing again. The same lady. Where she is standing is the coffin, and the relax where she is relaxing are the people. It feels as if right now people are in the place where she wanted people to have picnic, but she never sat down. And the answer to the question why did she never rest is because she sees herself. Can you go to the next drawing? She sees herself in the box. She was thinking of dying when she came to me. She had already gone on the net and found every way to die. She had actually tried to find out how do you order the medicine which she could consume and die. How can she rest when she sees herself in the coffin? How can you rest? And this is the subconscious programming that you can pick up from the drawings. It's just amazing. The more in depth you go, and this is all, if you look at all those figures, they don't have feet. They just stand like the penis is standing over there. It was yeah. unfulfilled sexual desire of being with her lover, where she could not be with her lover at all because he didn't really look at her as the way that she looked at him. It was more like he just, the cultural stories, and he didn't reject her, but he didn't accept her. She didn't know where she stood, and her desires were never going to be fulfilled, according to her. So she'd rather be dead than alive. She could only have picnic with him, and she could only think of her life if she could rest with him and be with him as a partner. Sometimes we fall in love with the person we should have never fallen in love with. And then life just becomes, and we are never able to talk about these secrets to anyone. So I hope these drawings like showed you how people have conflicts.
Yeah, this really does speak a lot. This reminds me of what Vinci says, the artist sees what the others only catch a glimpse of, and like you've literally just seen that. And it's so beautiful how you've incorporated these techniques and have added so much meaning, like even to a simple shadow. So that's really great to know. So we all are aware of the stigma surrounding mental health, but one thing 2020 may have been good for is clearing up some of it. So can you explain how it's relevant to us, in the sense, is mental health something everyone requires, or only those who are experiencing some sort of grave emotional trauma or stress?
It's not mental health that's required. It is what is required is we understanding that we have an opportunity to find who we are. And then there's an opportunity to be our authentic self. The problem with us is, Tarini, none of us are authentic with ourselves. So yes, mental health is required for anyone who's alive. Because this is one story that gave me life. But whether it's mental health, whether it was called meta medicine before, whether it changes its name, that's not important. And what's important is that this one subject makes you understand where you are in your life right now. And if you have a disease, why has that disease come in your life? In fact, it takes off all the superstitions that we would ever think of. It takes off the fear. If I take off the fear from your system, I can help you to live. It gives you a true hope to move ahead in your life. It makes you understand that when you actually go to the doctor and you are in pain and you are in agony, that's not the time when disease happened. Disease started much before that. Like your tooth pain happened only after the caries had actually started manifesting, a hole in your tooth had actually started happening. But you did not go to the doctor because it wasn't giving you pain. You went to the doctor to get rid of the pain, not get rid of the caries that you had in your tooth. So disease begins much before. And if we understand why is it that we are continuously making ourselves not at ease, why is it that we are continuously, constantly molding ourselves to help to fit into a square, a circle, a rectangle, or a triangle, so that our family members are happy. So let me give an example here. A child 6 days old is born with anger. Can she release that anger?
I don't think so, because she doesn't know she's angry.
Exactly. Do we even know we are angry? But if this kid was given an opportunity to study mental health, even if at age of 8 or 9, and kids have sat down in the class at age eight and nine, right up to 81-year-old has sat down in the workshop. And she understood that she was angry because she's a girl. She could do something about it. If I'm not even aware, you know, most of our life is in three sections. I don't know, I know, and I don't even know that I don't know. For example, I know that I'm Anu Mehta. I don't know what my tomorrow is going to be like. But I don't even know that I don't know that I could actually fall in love with the dogs. So, if somebody had told me 50 years back, you're going to keep a dog and have one at home, I would have looked at them and said, you must be a fool. I'm scared of dogs. Today I have one. So we don't even know what our potential is. Coming back to mental health and the question that you asked, COVID has been one time when people have actually been forced to take decisions because they couldn't pretend anymore in their houses. Unlike what you have seen, I was running the Zoom sessions at night for people, and I realized that any time that the window was left unmuted, we could hear screaming, shouting, howling at the back. There was so much of domestic violence that increased during this period because people did not have a place to escape or run to. This was one time when people seriously could not pretend in front of their loved ones. The family house that should have been a loving house had become jail for people. They did not have an office to go to. Husbands were at home. And it was as if things had fallen down. You had to deal with the stuff that was coming up for you. Children being locked up in the house with you for 6 months, 5 months, because everything was on lockdown. Really, you could run from one room to another. Beyond that, what? I think 2020 came into our life to really look at our mental health seriously. there is no shame in asking and sitting down with a therapist. Let me give you a small understanding of this. When you are bad at maths, don't you go to a tuition teacher and say, I want to learn maths. I'm poor with it. I need someone to explain it to me. In fact, we take pride in saying, I sent my child to this classes and now he's doing so well.
Yeah.
Well, a counselor is someone who helps you with life skills. She's also going to do the same thing as a tuition teacher. How about saying, I'm your tuition teacher for helping you to deal with certain parts of your life that you are finding it difficult to deal with. That's what a counselor is all about. And who is not mental?
Wow, you make it sound so easy. But this...
I don't know anyone who has never got angry. I don't know anyone who's never cried. I don't know anyone who's never laughed. And this in the psychological language would be called mood swings.
That's... Yeah, true. This is like a whole new world like unfolding in front of us, and I'm sure everyone has a lot of questions. So I'd like to open the house for audience questions now.
Can bipolar disease be treated with mental health? Yes, it can. So bipolar, let's look at what is bipolar. Two poles of the head. Bi means two. Poles, and one pole is connected with your femininity and the other pole is connected with your masculinity. We all know that we have all the four hormones in our body, which is the estrogen, the progesterone, the testosterone, and the androgens. When the androgen or the testosterone becomes more in your body, you go into manic. Manic doesn't mean man-like. Manic means you are basically becoming workaholic. And when you have more of progesterone or estrogen in your body, then you are slightly more on the dip. You can't be aggressive. So a lady who is very feminine would have more of progesterone in her body. And a man who is really macho, like the Rambo, would have more of testosterone in his body. Mm-hmm. Bipolarity is when people shift their moods very fast. It's like saying kabhi khushi kabhi gum. One minute they're happy, the other minute they're sad, and they're jumping, they're doing this jump between the two poles. We need to find out what was happening in their life. I'm repeating again, we need to find out what happened in their life around these themes. So I'll just list out the few themes. What happened in their life, whether they lost someone who was very important for them, whether they had a rejection from a boyfriend over with maybe husband, maybe father, some kind of rejection. Where they lost their identity, like a child moving from one school to another school, wherein he suddenly gets lower grades because the system is different. So what really made the person feel that her identity is lost? Or let's say the girl gets married and suddenly now everything in the new house is different and she cannot adjust. Okay. So a sudden change in her space. It could also be that there was a job that somebody was doing and that job was taken away from him or her. Or it could be that the person's car was taken away from him, house was taken away from him, boyfriend or girlfriend was taken away from him. Like when Pakistan and India war happened. How many people just left everything, their property, their rutba, their status, everything was left behind and then they came to India? Or India, say, there were people who went to Pakistan. Now, this is a standing example of how, or even now during COVID, how many stores have you heard have just shut down? Restaurants have just shut down. This is the onset of a disease called the depression and the manic. And yes, it can be sorted out. Most of the conventional therapists will go and give them medications. We believe in understanding what are the conflicts, sorting those conflicts out. Once you sort those conflicts out, and you need to understand these conflicts of behavioral change is to save the person, not to kill him. And you can't just take away their behavior from them. You can downgrade it. And definitely it can be downgraded and you can be in a better place. Thank you so much for that question.
So the next one we have is, how important is emotional release for your well-being?
Well, if you have emotions, you know that you are alive. The only person that does not have emotion is a dead body. So if... And emotion means something in motion. Something in motion means something is moving within you. Emotions are not bad. Emotions are good. Like they say, har daag achha hai. Just like that, in that ad that you have, har ghar achha hai. But you know, you need to know what really that emotion is, and can anybody be happy all the time? Not possible, yaar.
Sure.
Can anybody be sad all the time? Possible. But your emotions are a navigation tool to tell you where you are in life right now. That's all it is. And if you're alive, you will have various emotions. And with those emotions, you need to transform those emotions effectively to another emotion. We cannot destroy emotion. We cannot create emotion. But we can transform it. For example, I can transform my anger into something more beneficial. But who says anger is not beneficial? Anger tells me I'm not in depression. Anger gives me the charge to go out and show myself and do things. Anger becomes bad, or any emotion becomes bad, when it is beyond a certain boundary and you cannot, at the end of it, regulate it. I wouldn't even say control it, when you cannot regulate it. And when you cannot regulate it is when you're going to wonder what to do. So if you're emotionally stable, it means you're not feeling highs and the lows. And that's not possible. We all go through mood swings. All I would say is, anytime that you're feeling very low, go sit down with a friend, have a chat. Don't keep it up your chest. These are small things. Go watch a movie. Go lighten yourself. Go smile. Go do a neurographic painting. Go dance. Go jog. Do something that doesn't put you obsessed with an emotion. You can also do tapping technique, which is the tapping EFT that is done in various points. This is also a tapping technique which helps people to reduce stress and transform emotions effectively. I hope I've answered that.
I think you've answered it brilliantly, Mr. Mukherjee has understood. Mr. Kareem Ahmad asks us, could alcoholism or any addiction be related to past trauma?
It is always related to past trauma. So let's go with the addiction. Addiction, if we break down the word, D-I-O-N at the end says action not taken. So that's the first thing. Addiction does not always come because you were stressed out. Yeah, I repeat again. Addiction doesn't always happen because you were stressed out. Addiction starts very innocently. And let me take you there. You were sitting with the friends and friends were laughing with you and you were laughing with the friends. It was brilliant. And you were smoking because you didn't want to smoke, but your friends were smoking. And your friend said to you, "Hey, Fussad, smoke nahi karega hamare saath?" And you said, "Really, I don't smoke." Then you can't belong to us. Karke to dekh, nothing will happen. And then you say, "Okay, fine, let me try. What's the big deal?" So you took, and suddenly, is it going to be immediate magic? No. You realized that you were holding something in your hand. You were with your friends. The brilliant it was. You were all laughing. You were all sharing something brilliant. You were laughing and joking. And you felt completely connected. It's that completely connected feeling that you're trying to recreate again and again by reacting the act when you felt brilliant about yourself. That's what addiction is about. Addiction is not a disease. It is a good feel factor. You felt good. And so you did it. But slowly, your friends have disappeared. Now you're sitting in the room. You're sitting down with your Siggy. And you're recreating the same environment, because the minute you hold the ciggy, you're sitting in your room, even if your friends are not there. It takes your mind and your subconscious takes you straight back there, and you feel good. So it's a good feel factor. Get such people more friends, connect to them, make them feel loved, and the ciggy will walk away. Also, it's about holding. Similarly with alcohol, it starts as a social drinking and then it never ends because it made you feel good. Now, if you had a drink and it made you really feel lousy, you puked and you won't, maybe you won't try to reenact it. It depends on how you felt when you first started with it. I hope that answers the question properly.
Wow, I really explained it. Mr. Karan Kishore Parya asks us, question for Anu, could you please talk about the importance of conscious breathing to activate the different parts of the autonomic nervous system to find inner balance? Do you recommend any particular form of meditation?
Thank you so much, Karan, for that question. What I have understood that the only thing you can ever control, we love controlling things. I mean, if I had my way, I think, and if all the parents had their way, and if everyone had their way, this is what they would do. We would go, open up people's heads, refix the wiring, and make it comfortable for us. Yeah. The thing is that when I'm looking at something like what you're asking about breathing, breath is the only thing you can control. In fact, if you're breathing, that means that you are alive. So yes, conscious breathing is one of the very important things which we must practice for good health. It helps you to gain more oxygen, helps to get oxytocin into the body, helps you to feel really nice, because more oxygen means more oxygen to your cells, and more oxygen to your cells means more well-being and health. And this, anybody will tell you who is practicing, who's doing pranayama and sitting down with the breath, that it really, really is effective. Any kind of meditation, and this was very confusing for me right in the beginning, because somebody said, aankhe band karke meditate karo. Somebody said, aankhe khol ke meditate karo. Somebody said, awaaz karke meditate karo. Somebody said, awaaz kiye bina meditate karo. For me, my work is meditation. जो चीज में आप गुम हो जाओ और जिस चीज में आपको रब दिखता है, where you see God, that is meditation for me. To be really honest, I found my answers in sound healing, and since you asked, I will play it for you. So very interesting. I picked up two bowls just before I was to sit down here, and okay. So you can use Tibetan bowls like this. And just hear the sound. Just going to put off the AC so that you can hear the sound more clearly. If you place it on the body and someone plays it for you, your whole body actually carries the vibrations. The latest that I've been discovering and what I've understood is that the vibrations of sound are not just carried by our ears and are not just formed as a form of speech, but our speech, every consonant that we speak, every word that we speak, including the sounds like this, which I'll play for you again, actually move into the whole body. Our nervous system is connected with nerves and with our spinal cord. Look at our spinal cord. It's got all the nerves moving into every part of your body. That's why your body is moving. But the sound actually penetrates into your bones, into your muscles, into the bone marrow, into the nerves, into your whole system. Now, something like a sound therapy or sound healing, these are the new names that came in. But I've sat down and worked with Jan Zeiger, with people in India, and with Chintan Dalal, Priyanka Patel, we have Sujata Singhi, so many people who are doing sound today. What you need to understand, each person has a different way of teaching. But that's not important. What is important for you to understand that the vibrations that are emitted by the sound actually can calm your whole body down. It wouldn't matter after that whether you're keeping your eyes open or your eyes closed. Let me play this small instrument for you. Can still hear the sound and the vibration. It's not just the sound that's important, it's the vibrations that are important. You have so many more instruments like the gongs, big bowls, smaller ones. There is, like I said, where you see God, where you feel God, where you feel engrossed, use that. There is nothing called right, wrong meditation. There are people who use creative visualization for meditation. I could take you through creative meditation. But is that one programming? For me, what I understood, we'd like to put things in a box. Again, I repeat, the only thing you can control is your breath. And allow yourself to be free-flowing with that. And whatever calms you down. For me, I sit down with crayons, colors, paints. I do portraits. That calms me down. That can be another form of meditation. So go with what your heart resonates and heart says you to do. Fall in love with yourself. And that is the biggest meditation that you can ever do. Thank you.
Wow. You opened up a whole new world for us. And I think you all took away a lot. So thank you so much, Dr. Mehta, for joining us and always taking up this entire Meta Health and Mental Health world into that human term for us. And if you all enjoyed hearing Dr. Mehta today, please reach out to her directly. We will share a link with her contact details below. And I would like to thank all of you who joined us today and really look forward to bringing you many more such events to enable you to help live better and longer.
Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.